The airlines of the United States favor funding of a prototype test program to find out the problems of economics and safety and environment worthiness of the airplane. This is the 22nd year of the supersonic age. The military have been flying airplanes for nearly a quarter of a century. None of the horrors that have been discussed on the Senate floor have occurred. But we airlines have put up $82 million. Pan Am alone has put up $18 million banking on the prototype testing to prove the worth of the airplane. The manufacturers have put up $206 million. This is not a giveaway or a subsidy. This is a joint partnership between the manufacturers, the airlines, and the taxpayers. Let's go ahead and fly it and see if any of these horrors that some of the senators have been put up to saying about it are true.
If the funding does not come from Congress, can the airlines and other interested parties take up the burden themselves?
No, we cannot afford to make the developmental investment for a U.S. supersonic transport. But if there is no U.S. transport, we will be forced by the foreign flag carriers such as BOAC and Air France to buy some foreign-built supersonic transports in order to stay in the air transport race, which we've always been able to lead and win before now.
Reverend Weaver, why did your church members decide to undertake this program?
We have had several calls for help to people who are in need, and the children of our church back early in the fall began collecting food to give to someone, and we decided to put it all together with all organizations working together and bring it in on one Sunday rather than spreading it out from time to time through the year.
How did it work this morning?
Oh, we were thrilled. We set as our goal a ton of food to be brought to the sanctuary today and put inside the chancel rail during the worship service. We had maybe 2 tons of food. I don't know. It's been a tremendous response.
Well, is this primarily a Christmas program?
Not really, though certainly the Christmas spirit prompted it. It is a program to meet emergency needs of people who are hungry and without food all during the winter. Rather than doing it on Christmas Eve as a Christmas basket concept, we have a pantry and we will be helping people all through the year.
Big fence around it, and I've gotten 2 German Shepherd dogs, and I've armed my family and taught them how to use the weapons.
How have the burglaries here affected your family psychologically?
Well, it's been very disturbing to my wife and I, as well as our children. It particularly my little girl, I think, when she found all her stuff in her room gone through, she's had nightmares for several weeks after it happened, and it was quite traumatic.
The council may ban rock concerts at the auditorium because of excessive damage to the building in the past. City Manager Howard McMahon pointed out some of the vandalism, which includes glass broken out of doors, door fixtures damaged, obscenities painted on the walls, box seats cut and marred, and microphones and electrical cords stolen or damaged, and damage to the restrooms. Most of the damage has been repaired, but management of the auditorium would like to end the vandalism in the future. The problem may not be ended by a ban on the rock concerts themselves. The council could just raise a damage deposit on the auditorium. A figure of $5,000 has been mentioned. That, of course, would discourage any future rock concerts here. Jim Green, Channel 8 News on the Move, Fort Worth.
Well, I think that's a part of it. It seems to me that it's a community-wide problem. The schools have direct responsibility. The police department, our courts have responsibilities. The parents have responsibilities, and it requires all of us working together to solve the problem. At Pinkston in particular, we have a school community guidance center. We have a representative from the police department, representative from the juvenile court, along with two of our own visiting teachers. They actually office in Pinkston High School and work out of there, and we have found that that has been most successful.
Of Israel has desired to look for compensation in two areas, compensation figuratively speaking. One, military equipment to counterbalance what has happened on the canal. And as you know, it's no secret that the United States government have responded to Israel's request in this regard. And secondly, the government has desired to obtain from the United States certain assurances vis-a-vis these negotiations. First, that this military aid of which I've just spoken would continue throughout 71 and beyond, no matter how these negotiations would go, no matter how the chips would fall in these negotiations. Secondly, we have a great financial problem. That is going to be the main subject of my briefing here in Dallas, as it is in every community. We have a tremendous financial burden. I'll say something about this perhaps in a moment. And there are the beginnings of the United States' response to these needs, as you know, for the first time in the history of my country. It has occurred unto Congress to ask for an appropriation for military needs for Israel. That's never yet happened before. We've had civilian aid over the years from the United States, but never in the military area.